Good evening and welcome to night number two, amen, the Friday night service, our missions conference. Let's all stand together and turn to number 178 in your hymnals, number 178. We're going to sing the first verse of this song, The Bible Stands. This is our theme song for the conference. Hymn number 178, as we stand, we'll sing that first verse together, amen, 178. We have the Word of God that stands. Amen. Let's turn to number 436 for our next hymn. 436. 436. Yeah, we could go on. We could do that again. Amen. 436. We'll remain standing as we sing, Bring Them In. 436 as we stand.
And night number two, it is great to see Mike and Megan here. You guys snuck in late, didn't you? Praise the Lord. That is a real blessing. And great to see the rest of you as well. Amen. Wow. I'm expecting great things tonight because of who our God is. Amen. And that His Holy Spirit will meet with us, fill us, speak to us, and we'll make application. We'll leave here changed people. Amen. I've asked Pastor Dirksen to come open us up in prayer.
And let's pray. Father in heaven, we do thank you for this evening. Lord, we thank you for the word of God. Lord, the power of the gospel to change lives, to save sinners. And Lord, we thank you for the great commission, the job that you've given a church. Lord, the purpose that we have. And Lord, that desire that we have to just allow you to work in and through us. And Lord, that's what we pray for tonight. We pray for the Holy Spirit of God to accomplish a work here tonight that man cannot accomplish. Lord, we pray for hearts to be stirred. Lord, that each one of us would be motivated to do your will for our lives. And so, Lord, we pray especially for the missionaries that will be presenting. Pray for Brother Marielli as he preaches. Lord, for the song service, the special, each part of this service. May it honor and glorify you. And Lord, may it just stir our hearts. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Yesterday, I gave a little bit of a challenge at the start of the service out of Philippians 2, verse 13. Of course, our theme being holding forth the word of life, that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, amen. And you know, we can even rejoice now, but especially in that day, what a day that's going to be. We will never regret being a witness and a missionary for the Lord Jesus, amen. And so tonight I want us to focus on verses 14 and 15. And I'm just going to read them. I'm going to read verse 14 first. It says, do all things without murmurings and disputings. Murmurings and disputings cause division. And one means to grumble and complain, and the other means a vocal expression of doubt. And we ought not have that in our Christian lives, amen? And I know we're probably all guilty of it at one time or another, but the Bible's very clear that we should do all things without murmurings and disputings. And it's so important for us, especially as I ask that we think about our testimony tonight. You know, last night we talked about God wanting to work through us, his will and his good pleasure. And tonight I want us to focus a little closer to our hearts on who are we? What does our testimony look like in a lost and dying world? God wants to prepare us for a life of service and a life of rejoicing, amen? And that's really what we ought to be now already. We ought to have that spirit of rejoicing. And, you know, sometimes we see Christians walking around and they're a little bit, just distraught and maybe not happy as they should be, but we ought to be happy. We ought to be the happiest people on earth. We have an eternal home in heaven, amen? And verse 15 says, that ye may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God. How? By not murmuring and disputing. And without rebuke in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation among whom ye shine as lights in the world. You know what God desires is for us to live holy as he is holy. That's really what he wants. That's what he wants for me, and that's what he wants for each one of us. We are to be an unmixed people, unadulterated people. You know, and the one illustration I just want to share before I move on to another verse here, and then we'll be done. Have you ever taken a sieve and put flour in it? And when you shake that sieve, the flour just, it has to pass through little holes in the screen. And what it really does, and especially in the days when flour wasn't as pure as we find it today in our stores, but it would separate the impurities in the flour. And what would come out was pure. And why? Because it was sifted. It was looked at in a very precise way. Every little particle had to go through a separate hole. And that's what we really need to do in our life. We need to allow the Lord to just take our whole life and just kind of lay it out and spread it apart. And every little particle, deal with it. Remove all the impurities. And that's what we need to do. That's what I need to do in my life. And I was so burdened by this morning as I was reading this passage. Every thought, everything I see, everything I listen to, all of it needs to pass through the sieve of God's holy word and through the leading and guiding of his Holy Spirit. Every part of my life, not just the parts that serve in church or that I use when I meet people and want to minister, but every part of my life. And then all the impurities are removed. And then we are blameless and harmless, the sons of God, without rebuke in the midst of a perverse and crooked nation, among whom ye shine as lights in the world, amen? And that's our purpose. Only then can we go back to the earlier in the previous chapter and approve those things that are excellent, Paul said to the Philippians. Only then do we know what's excellent, when we have that testimony. Paul said this in 2 Timothy 4:18, and the Lord shall deliver me from every evil work and will preserve me unto his heavenly kingdom, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Who will do that? The Lord will. Yeah. He will do that through his word and his Holy Spirit. Amen. He will sift us like flour. Just like the devil wanted to sift Peter, the Lord does a much better job. He removes all the impurities. And so our prayer tonight, may it be that God would pass us through the sieve, every part of our life, every part of my life tonight. And if there are any impurities in my life, Lord, would you please remove them? Lord, so I can have a life that is prepared to serve you wholeheartedly, every part of me. Not just some parts, every part. D.L. Moody said this, "There will be no peace in any soul until it is willing to obey the voice of God." No peace. Do you got peace in your heart tonight? I trust you do. And I'm so excited. I'm excited for you. I'm excited for me because I want God to do a work. And our prayer before we came in here was that there would be a change not just for tonight, but a lasting change in my life and in the life of this church and each one of us. Amen. And I trust that'll be your prayer tonight. I'm going to ask the gentleman to get the presentation ready, the camera or projector ready. And I have I try not to get too emotional. Last year we had Pastor Bill Wall, preach our mission conference. And I had the privilege of attending his funeral about a month ago. I also had the privilege of attending the ordination of his son to take his place. And I asked Billy if he could send me the video that he prepared. And so I want to show you that at this time. We can get the lights dimmed as well, please. And whenever you're ready.
We are the Wall family. My name is Billy. We are the Wall family. My name is Billy, my wife Liz, our daughters Natalie and Allison, and our son Joshua. We are missionaries in Cuauhtémoc, Chihuahua, Mexico, the land of corn and apples. It is also a place where three cultures meet, the Tarahumara, the Mexican, and the Mennonite. For the last 12 years, we have been working under my dad, Bill Wall, until his passing the beginning of last month. I am humbled that the church called me as their new pastor. As we strive to keep all the ministries going, would you pray for us? The church has allowed us to use its pastoral house, for which we are thankful, but due to its age and its many problems, it's becoming unlivable. My wife's health has even been affected because of the constant humidity inside the house. A few years ago, the Lord gave us a beautiful piece of land to build on, although the process has been slower than what we thought. Would you help us pray for time and resources to finish this house? Moving out of our current house would allow us to use it as storage for the church, which in turn would give us a few extra classrooms that we desperately need. From the bottom of our hearts, thank you for your prayers and your support. Without you, we couldn't be doing this work, which we so much enjoy.
Together in short time, because there's a great need. We have the privilege of supporting Pastor Wall and his wife Martha, and now just Martha and her daughters as they serve full-time in that ministry. But Pastor Billy Wall, his son now, you saw the house that he has there. That house was there when we were there for Abe and Mabel's wedding, and it was incomplete, and it's still incomplete as they're just short of money. They just don't have money to finish it. And they really need a place to live. And so he's very humble to even ask for any support. And he's not able to leave and not able to present his ministry church to church. And so I'm going to challenge our church. To pray about supporting that ministry. We'll be looking at maybe having him come in the future, but right now it's just a very volatile time with losing his dad, and I'm sorry for getting emotional. His dad was a good friend, and I could confide in him, and he would even confide in me, and I don't know why, but we would pray together and laugh together and cry together. And I even had the opportunity to preach a conference with him in the German language. And it was quite incredible because he's well-seasoned and I'm not. And there was never an issue. He never brought it up. No one brought it up. And I'm blessed, very blessed. And so I want to challenge our church just to pray about that, if you could, please. And we'll talk about that in the future. Amen. Amen. At this time, I want to introduce one of our missionaries, and I'll just let those live streaming once again know that we will be showing a video that you will be able to live stream, but there will be a portion of his presentation that you will not be able to see on the live stream due to the sensitivity of the mission and the mission field. And so I'm very excited to have Connor and Janelle here. Of course, Connor is Jesse's brother. And there's a lot of excitement here. Linda's son, and of course Joel and Willem, and all family, and it's close to home, amen. And it's exciting to have someone close to home surrender their life to missions, and not only just surrender, but to have the opportunity to get behind them. And so I'm not going to take any more of his time. I'm going to ask him to come. I think he's going to introduce the video. We'll play the video right away, and then he's going to take some time and just share his heart. Amen. Connor, you come. And we're so thankful that you were able to be with us. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Pastor Friesen.
Amen.
It is truly a privilege to be here. Like Pastor Friesen said, I'm Linda's son, Jesse's brother. I'm the one they don't talk about. So if you've never heard about me, that's why. I'm the one they never talk about. But my name is Connor Colburn. I'm going to ask my wife to stand, Janelle. And I think Martha Dirksen kidnapped our son. He's 4 weeks old today, and so we're so excited to have him. He's a real answer to prayer, and I'd love to take the time to share that, but that's not why I'm here. But we are missionaries to a creative access nation, and that just means we're missionaries to a place where missionaries are illegal. I'm going to have the guys show the video, and then I'll tell you a little bit more specifically about where the Lord has called us and what he's planning on doing with us there. So I'll have you guys play the video at this time. Covering 20% of the globe and containing countless inhabited islands, the Indian Ocean is 4 times larger than Russia and 10 times larger than the United States. This part of the world contains 2.5 billion people. That's more than a quarter of the world's current population. The people who live here make up iconic countries like Australia, Madagascar, and Saudi Arabia. And then some less known, if not unknown, countries like the Maldives, Timor-Leste, and Comoros. If you were to travel this area and ask people what faith they follow, what religion they believe, the most common answers would be Hinduism, Islam, Buddhism, Sikhism, and also prevalent would be Catholicism and animism, or tribal religions. Although seemingly different from each other, these belief systems all have a unifying thread. They're characterized by hopelessness and no assurance of eternal life. We are the Colburns. Our burden is to serve the Lord in Creative Access countries. A Creative Access country is a country that is officially closed to missionary activity, or where the governments have placed severe restriction on that activity. Due to various civil, political, economic, and religious factors, traditional missions is often not possible in these countries, thus necessitating a creative approach. Out of the 43 countries that border the Indian Ocean, Christianity is restricted or forbidden in 34 of them. The countries that claim Islam as their primary religion are almost exclusively closed to missionaries, or Christianity is completely forbidden. This has resulted, unfortunately, in this part of the world being among the most unreached, with the fewest number of missionaries going there. I was saved as a 15-year-old boy in the spring of 2008, after hearing a message on the subject of hell at a youth conference. The next day, I asked a counselor what the next step was, and he encouraged me to give my life to Christ and to say yes to whatever he would have me do. Through a series of circumstances, the Lord led me to Canadian Baptist Bible College, where I graduated with a bachelor's degree in theology and a minor in missions. As I continued to serve in my church, the Lord led me to pursue and marry my wife in 2019. As we sought the Lord about what he would have us do, he laid on our hearts Creative Access nations, specifically those overlooked and forgotten places, places that seem impossible to reach.
I had the privilege of growing up in a Christian home where I made a profession of faith at a young age. The only thing I remember about that day was that it was after a 5-day Bible club in our front yard. I began to doubt my salvation until June 19, 2005. It was at that time that I attended a ladies' tea in my church. The speaker encouraged us that salvation was so important that you should settle the matter. I'm so glad that I settled it on that day. Since that time, I've been involved in weekly Bible clubs and VBSs. My favorite part is telling the missionary story to the children. I've also been able to serve in the nursery, care home services, and various outreach ministries. It's truly an honor to serve the Lord. On May 12, 2010, I surrendered to go wherever God wanted me to go. He also gave me a special burden for reaching the unreached.
Hi, I'm Pastor Mike Sullivan of Pimina Valley Baptist Church in Winkler, Manitoba, the home church for Connor and Janelle Colburn, missionaries to the Creative Access Nations. They have a heart for God. They're busy in their local church serving the Lord, and they feel called of God to go into the highways and byways of the seemingly closed countries. But we praise the Lord that the Word of God is not bound. I trust that you'll prayerfully consider supporting Connor and Janelle to your missions family. Thank you so much.
Our plans upon reaching the field are to work with a veteran missionary while we learn the culture and the primary language of that area. Our goal is, of course, to reach people with the gospel, to be obedient to the Lord when he said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. As our language abilities increase, we want to be able to reach out to people, to win them to Christ, as we see people won to Christ, we want to plant churches, strong churches, that can reach their Jerusalem and then spread out and reach the regions beyond. There are many places where I cannot get a visa or where I cannot minister effectively, but nationals can. I believe that for the work to continue and to be successful, and I believe the Bible bears this out, strong churches and strong believers are a necessity. As you look at a map of the Indian Ocean, something you may notice that certainly jumps out at me are the many islands. The Indian Ocean boasts 57 different island groups. That's not islands, that's just groups of islands, hundreds of islands. That number multiplies into the thousands of islands as you travel through Malaysia, Indonesia, and into the Philippine Islands. On many of these islands, the average person's knowledge of Jesus Christ is limited to those few references in the Quran, or perhaps something they saw online, on a YouTube video, or on a news site. Some have never even heard his name. Many of them, in fact, have never heard his name. Separated by hundreds and sometimes thousands of miles, the people of these islands are born, they live, then they die, never having heard that God loves them, never having heard that Jesus died for them. These are the people the Lord has called us to reach. These people who are overlooked and forgotten. These people who, to the majority of us, to myself included, up until a couple years ago, were unknown. I didn't even know they existed. These places categorically fall under the classification of closed. It's hard to get in. They're not open for missionaries. Thankfully, we have the promise of God that all things are possible with Him. And we have His command to preach the gospel to every creature. I want to be obedient to that command. These places are overlooked, forgotten, and some would say unreachable. And that begs the question, who can reach the unreachable? Well, the simple answer is this, only God can. But God wants to use you, and God wants to use me to do that. Will you pray as we seek to go to these overlooked and forgotten places? And would you ask the Lord what part He would have for you in the reaching of these untold millions?
Magnify the Lord with me, ye people of To the cross of the Lamb of God, lay all your guilt on Him. Freely His lifeblood He sacrificed, paying the debt of your sin. Come to the cross upon Calvary. Gaze on the scene anew. Turn from your sin to the Savior. There Jesus waits for you. Stand by the tomb where His body lay. Hear how the mourners cry. If they but knew why the Savior came, Jesus left heaven to die. Come to the cross upon Calvary. Gaze on the scene anew. Turn from your sin to the Savior. There Jesus waits for you. Kneel at the throne of your risen Lord. Death now has lost its sting. Thanks be to God for the victory. Hail to your conquering King. Come to the cross upon Calvary. Gaze on the scene anew. Turn from your sin to the Savior. Come now. Christ waits for you.
turn to number 423 in your hymnals, number 423. Sing, we've a story to tell. 423.
A story to tell to the nations that shall turn their hearts to the right. A story of truth and mercy, a story of peace and light, a story of peace and light. For the darkness shall turn to dawning, and the dawning
few quick announcements, just so everyone is clear on the schedule. Following the evening service tonight, of course, we have the fellowship downstairs and a special youth afterglow right upstairs here in the sanctuary. So youth, make sure that you stay here for that. And then tomorrow morning at 9 a.m., we have the men's breakfast.
Amen.
Amen. And so we'll see all the men there. And ladies, your tea is at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. So a busy day tomorrow, a good day coming up. And then Sunday, the very next day, for Sunday school, we have Miss Hannah's teaching the children's classes, ages 3 through 11, in the main area downstairs. The youth are upstairs. And so that's a special Sunday school there. And then a Parade of Nations is Sunday night at 6 p.m., where the children can dress up and be a Parade of Nations. And then following that, the very last item on our itinerary is that infamous International Sweet and Savory Fellowship. That'll follow that Sunday evening service. I'm not sure if someone brought a taste tester for me to try here tonight. Brother Merriwell, is that yours?
That's mine.
Amen. All right. Well, I'll leave it then. But we're asking the church family for that event to bring...
She's guilty.
Amen. Can I have a piece, Mary? Do I have to ask Brother Merriwell? Okay. I'll ask him. But we're asking the church family if you could bring a dessert, sweet and or savory, of the country of your choice, and cut it into bite-sized pieces and label it and bring it for that special fellowship, that would be wonderful.
Bites.
And so, well, we all have different size bites. Amen. But that is it for announcements. At this time, we'll stand, shake hands, and greet one another.
And as we find our places, we'll remain standing. And I believe Parker's going to come help us with the missions offering. Thank you, Parker. And as was mentioned yesterday, all the proceeds tonight will be heading to our missionary families that are in attendance tonight. And then we'll be singing, "He Wants Me to Pray, to Give, and to Go."
He wants me to pray, to give, and to go, that the world may know about Jesus. He wants me to pray, to give, and to go, that the whole world may know about Jesus. He wants me to pray, to give, and to go, that the world may know about Jesus. He wants me to pray, to give, and to go, that the whole world may know about Jesus.
Amen. Thank you, Parker. You did a great job. Amen. Let's turn to number 439 in your hymnals, number 439. We'll remain standing together for our final hymn. We'll sing "Work, for the Night is Coming." 439 as we stand. 439.
Work, for the night is coming.
And before Jake comes and prays for the offering, I just want to mention again, you'll find these in the back of the hymnal. If you would like to give towards the missionaries, please mark it benevolent and just put whatever amount in there that the Lord lays on your heart. And so anything marked benevolent or anything that is undesignated in the offering tonight will go completely to the missionaries. Amen. Not for their hotel rooms, not for any of that. It'll go to them for a love offering. Amen. And so, Brother Jake, why don't you come and pray? Amen.
Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for tonight. Thank you for just allowing us to come together again in your house. Lord, I just ask that you meet with us like you did last night. Pray that you just do a work in our hearts. Pray for the offering, that it would be used to reach the ones that haven't heard your name before, Lord. Thank you for everything that you do. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Thank you.
where else in this town are you going to go and see 14 teenagers doing that? Is there any place? Is there any place that you're going to go and hear teenagers sing that message and obviously mean it? There wasn't one of those that was just singing words. You could tell on the expressions of their faces they meant it. That all the world may know. You see, that's a big deal for me. Because I wasn't saved until I was 15. And so I didn't get all of that. I didn't have the benefit of experiencing Sunday school and learning all the Bible stories of Sunday school and enjoy youth groups and camps and VBS and all the things that we just take for granted. I hope that not one of you people here take any of this for granted. God is doing something very special in your midst and is giving you opportunities to prepare for something bigger than you can imagine or think in the days ahead. That's exciting. It's exciting to be a part of it. 2 Corinthians chapter 8. Let's pray together. Our Father, we enter into your presence with thanksgiving. We rejoice in your mercy and your grace. We thank you for your truth. We thank you for the day that we personally saw our need for a Savior and was miraculously born again. Thank you for the day that our name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Thank you for the Holy Spirit's seal until the day of redemption. Thank you for the joy of the Lord that we're able to experience because of a walk with you. Thank you that we can trust you for direction, for wisdom, for guidance. Thank you that your plan for us is so amazing. And Father, we all would agree that we want to be in a place where we can experience all of what that plan is. Lord, we want to be in a place where we can be in the places that you want us to be. Because we know that if a Christian is not in the place that he ought to be, then at that time, that place is empty. And to think about that place being empty is so humbling and staggering. We don't want that. So keep us in the places that you want us to be at the time you want us to be there, and make us awesomely aware of why you have us there. And then give us boldness to accomplish what you want us to accomplish while we're there. Lord, as I see these young people and hear all the children coming for the offering and watch the youth before and after services and realize you're preparing generations to serve you, it's so exciting to think about what that's going to be. As we see the missionary presentations tonight and see how that you have taken us to places that we perhaps have never seen. These young people can go and reap the benefits of what these missionaries are pioneering paths for them to come behind them and accomplish great things for you. Lord, thank you that there's so many that want to. I pray you direct them. Father, we love you. And I know that we need to say we love you too. Because you first loved us. We thank you so much for it. So unlovable. So full of sin and wickedness. And yet, just as I am, without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, just as I am. You're not asking us to add anything to or take anything away from, just to come as we are, so that you can do a work in our lives, preparing us for your service. Would you please open our eyes in your word to behold wondrous things for a moment? Lord, I don't have any idea why I can't get this off my mind, and so you have to do what I know only you want to do. It certainly has nothing to do with me. Lord, I pray that my words would become your words, and your words would become my words, and as my words go out to the hearers, that they would land on ears that could understand what you have to say. And I pray that you would prepare our hearts willing to obey what you have for us during these moments. Lord, I pray not one person would leave this auditorium in disobedience, but in full obedience and surrender to your desired will. Thank you that you use us. In Jesus' precious name, I pray by faith. Amen. In 2 Corinthians 8, and verse number 5, I know your pastor has gone through expositionally these verses, and I'm not going to repeat that tonight. I just want to draw one short phrase out of verse number 5 and then go from there. And that is, it says, "And this they did, not as we hoped, but this is what they did. They first gave their own selves to the Lord, and unto us by the will of God." They first gave their own selves to the Lord. Can you imagine being able to say that in life? Can you imagine being able to grow up with this environment that these young people have the opportunity to grow up in? And to be able to say, as far back as they can think, they first gave their own selves to the Lord? Can you imagine all that they could be spared from? All the wickedness, all the devices of the world, all the things that Satan wants to come as a roaring lion, walking about seeking whom he may... What's that next word? Why is it not kill? Satan's not interested in killing. Satan's not interested in just wiping you out. He's interested in making you suffer. He's interested in making it as bad for you as he possibly is given opportunity to do. Because he knows the worse it is for you, the more you will affect against the Lord. Nobody goes down alone. If you were to watch a pride of lion and their process of seeking whom they can devour, they do it in a pack, a pride. They do it in a group, right? Because they know as a group, they can isolate one. And once that one becomes isolated, once that one leaves the protection of their herd or their group or whatever that they are in, once that one decides they're going to veer off a little bit and try to get away off this way, and the whole rest of them go that way, but that one wants to go that way, as soon as that one left the safety of the herd, the devouring takes place. And Satan knows and has so many people under the device of lies in regards to the protection of this right here. There's good protection right here. When somebody in this protection decides that they don't like this protection anymore and they want to go out there and try it somewhere else, you've just opened yourself up to the devouring process of the roaring. Why does it say roaring? You ever think about it? Why does it say roaring? Why not just a purring lion? Why is it a roaring lion? Because he doesn't want to kill, he wants to devour. And if you study that out, when that lion gets that one that's isolated himself into a place where he can begin the devouring, he doesn't go for the kill. He doesn't try to get his teeth in the jugular. No, he tries to get his teeth in the prime rib. He tries to get it in what tastes good first. He's hungry. And in that process of not killing the animal first, he's devouring the animal first. And it's not until sometime later that that animal takes the last breath. It suffers unbelievable in that process. And as you think about all these young people that have the opportunity to say first at 4 or 3 or 5 or 7 or whatever year number that it was when they understood the things of what this church is trying to teach, and they embraced that and it became a part of their life, and from that day forward they just went forward for the Lord. First gave themselves to the Lord. Man, what a privilege is yours. Sunday school teacher, thank you. Thank you for taking the time that you take to study this book and to prepare lessons to teach those children the benefits of first giving themselves to the Lord. Youth workers, thank you for the time that you invest away from all the things that you could be doing, instead investing your lives into these teenagers to allow them to keep those things that they decided to do years before and not give up when it's easiest to give up by the peer pressure of all those around here that's trying to get them to go another way. Thank you for your time. Thank you for your effort. If you feel like that, you wonder sometimes if it's worth it or not. It's worth it. Amen? It's worth it. First, gave themselves to the Lord. Go over to my life verse, Romans chapter 12, if you would. Every time I have the privilege to sign a Bible, and every time that happens, I want you to know how humbling it is to ever be able to do it. But I always sign Romans 12, 1 through 3. And as many times as I possibly can, I always look at the person and I ask him, do you know that verse? If the answer is no, I say, read it. Memorize it. It could become your life verse. It became my life verse in 1980. I wasn't saved until I was 15. Prior to 15, my life had no knowledge of any of this, as I've already said. Nothing. Except one little glimmer of light. When Hannah's video started and that one little glimmer of light starts that video, man, I was done. I was done right there. I'm not sure if I got any more of that video. That just took me right out. Because that one little glimmer of light, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. What's a lamp do? A lamp basically shows you the area where you are. A lamp doesn't show you down the road. It shows you where you are right now. And all these people that were discussing during this missions conference have no idea where they are in their lost condition without Christ. They have no idea their sin separates them from a holy God. And the scripture very clearly tells us that he has kept the light of the gospel away from them. Satan has on purpose, because he knows once a glimmer of light gets to them, he loses. As long as he can keep this away, don't you think he's got a master plan in place? If half the world doesn't have one word of the Word of God, who authored that? God didn't author that. Not at all. He told us to go into all the world and preach the gospel. Yeah, but preacher, just by the things that we've heard tonight, is that even possible? I don't know. Dr. Keene says, why would he ever command us to go somewhere that he knew we would never be able to get to? That doesn't make any sense. And then why would he hold us responsible at the judgment seat of Christ? Because we didn't get there. That really doesn't make sense. So we know it can happen. We just have to realize that lamp is powerful, but not only is it a lamp, it's also a light. A light shows us where we're going. How many of you know where you're going after you die? Isn't that wonderful? To put your hand up and say, I know where I'm going. What's your authority on that? It is the authority in all that we do. It is the authority. It is what guides us in every decision that we make. Amen? Praise the Lord for the lamp. Praise the Lord for the light. And there was this one preacher. His name was Archie Graham. And Archie Graham would come to our place of business as I was growing up. My dad owned a gas station, party store, and motel back in the 60s and 70s. That's the atmosphere that I grew up in. Very wicked atmosphere. Nothing about it. Anyway, just very wicked atmosphere. But this preacher would drive about 15 miles away from where he lives, and he'd come to that gas station, and he'd get gas. And every time he got gas, he always left a gospel tract. I don't know. I know I never read one. I don't know if my mom and dad ever read one. I have no idea. But I know that it was a little glimmer of light for what might take place in the future. And he just was faithful. He never pressed you or anything. It was just read it if you have time. I'll tell you about heaven. Just a little glimmer of light. And then one night, my mom's sister-in-law invited her to a preaching meeting. Back in the day, in the 70s, in the States, we used to have what was called citywide crusades. The citywide crusades were, back then, believe it or not, independent fundamental Baptist churches could get along one with another. I know that's shocking, but that's the way that it was back then. And there would be like 10 or 15 churches that would come together of like faith, like practice, same Bible, and they would rent out a football stadium if it was in the summer, a high school basketball gym if it was in the winter. This happened to be in the winter. The preacher's name was Billy Walker. And Billy Walker came into that high school gymnasium in Morenci, Michigan, and preached the gospel. And I was there, and my mom was there. And I have no idea what he said. I can't tell you one word that preacher said in the message. Not any. I don't know the text he used. Honestly, I wasn't there to hear him. I had other things on my mind while I was there, while I was sitting as far back in the gymnasium as I could, in the very top row of the bleachers. so I could see everybody that I wanted to see. I had no idea anything about anything else until the invitation. In the invitation, he said this, and I quote, he said, if on your way home tonight, you were to be hit head-on by an 18-wheeler and sent out into eternity, where would you spend forever? I heard that. And as far as I was concerned, that night I had an appointment with an 18-wheeler. And I found my way off those bleachers down to that platform area where somebody took me back to another room and showed me the gospel. And that night I received Jesus Christ as my personal Savior. And I have people say to me, they say, so you were saved because of fear. So you call it whatever you want. I don't really care what you call it. All I know is that's the day that I got saved. Amen? And you can call it fear if you want. I'm still as convinced today as I was that day. I had an appointment with an 18-wheeler. And it wouldn't have been just me because I wasn't driving. But that appointment got taken away. Amen? Amen? And that night I received Jesus Christ as my personal Savior, and everything began to change at 15 years old. Some people, when they get saved, it's a process. Well, everybody, when they get saved, it's a process. Some people, when they get saved, it's a quicker process than others, right? Some, they get saved, and they just start getting excited real quick about the things of the Lord, about the Word of God, and about prayer, and about church attendance, and about soul winning, and all the different things. I just got excited about all of it. And it didn't take me time for any of that to happen. Within 1 year, my entire family was saved. Within 1 year. Unbelievable. My dad was a drunk, an alcoholic, a chain smoker. He wasn't abusive. He never was abusive with any of it. But that was him. And he was the last one to get saved in the family. When he got saved, it all went away overnight. Everybody can't give that testimony, and I know that. I know it's a very difficult thing to give up that life. But for my dad, it was gone. It never did come back. And from the day that my mom and I got saved forward, now this many years later, as far as we know, everybody in our family knows Jesus Christ as their Savior. You never know. You never, ever know when that one person gets saved what the repercussion of that is going to be down through the years. You never know. But my, how exciting that it is. At 17 years old, I was sitting in the third row from the front. I know you've heard this from me before, but it's worth repeating. I like the third row from the front. And I notice that hasn't set in here, must be, because the third row is kind of empty right there in the aisle. That's the seat. Those of you that want to be preacher boys, that seat right there in front of you. If I was you, I'd get up and move right now. That one right there. That's where the glory comes down, right? Third row from the front. You're in the third row from the front. You're just on the wrong side, but that's okay over there too. You know, I tell people all the time, there's nothing wrong with sitting in the back. There really isn't. I'm serious. I don't want you to think that I'm making you feel guilty. I don't know why preachers sit so far back, but anyway, there's nothing wrong with you sitting as far back as you do, but everybody should experience sitting towards the front of a church at least once. The one thing you'll experience that you never even knew is possible, when you sit in the front, you feel like that you're in the choir instead of singing a solo back there. It's one of the reasons why a lot of people don't sing out from the back, because you feel like you're all by yourself. Come up here. You'll get drowned out. You won't even be able to hear yourself. Then you can do what Dr. Jack Hudson used to say, just open up and let her rip. Amen. Oh, some of you are looking at me a little funny. You're looking at me like, well, you know, if you could hear me sing, you would want me to open up and let her rip. Okay. Who gave you your voice? Did he make a mistake? You see, we get so concerned about what other people hear and what other people think that we sing way down here to impress the person right there. Then we sing way up here to impress the person behind us, and we do all that weird stuff. God's not impressed. He already knows what you sound like. Forget about the people that are sitting around you and just sing for the glory of God. Amen? If you come to the front, you might find yourself doing that. Go ahead and give it a try every now and then. You'll like it. Why are you back there so far? You're looking at me like a, yeah, I'm looking right at you. Yeah, guilty, aren't you? Feeling guilty? That seat's still open. Amen. And I was sitting there. Where was I sitting? Third row from the front. I was sitting right there. And the preacher, his name is Keith Corbin. My pastor, Keith Corbin, passed away just 2 weeks ago. At, I think, 94 years of age. Tennessee Temple grad. And he was preaching, and I was sitting right there, and I remember as clearly as I'm standing before you right now, getting up from that seat and coming to the altar and saying, Lord, I don't know what you want me to do. I don't know where you want me to go. And I don't know when you want to do it through me. But whatever it is, and wherever it is, and whenever it is, here am I. Send me. My life changed that night. Remember I said last night that there's a process that you go through? I gave you the basics of the process last night from being saved and baptized and joining the church and giving and getting involved in all the different things. We went through that process, but there's also a process of becoming what you see these missionaries that are doing tonight. It's a process. And for many of you, that process starts a long time ago. For me, that process started at 15 years of age, and I didn't even know it. I had no idea that God, what God was preparing for me. I had no idea what God was preparing for me. At 18, now a senior in high school, I remember meeting the preacher in the front during an invitation and saying to the preacher, I don't know how to go about this, but you remember when I surrendered to full-time service? He said, I remember that. I said, I need to go prepare for that. How do I go about that? So he began to counsel me about where I needed to go and what I needed to do. It was really one of the funniest things that's ever happened in my wife and I's life because our pastor is a graduate at Tennessee Temple University back in the 60s. And he said, well, Brent, you and Shelley need to go to Tennessee Temple. So we said, okay. I never had a problem if the preacher said you need to do something and just say okay with it. That's never been a problem for me. It was never a problem for me right after I got saved that the preacher set me down and explained to me about how important it was to begin tithing. I was already working then. I told you about that last night. I already had the job in the apple orchard. I had an income. I had no problem with the preacher telling me what it was like to tithe. Never have had a problem with that. I never had a problem when the preacher said, make sure that you're in all the services. I never had a problem with that. My dad never had a problem with that, evidently, because I can remember specifically one day in the winter of 1972. Remember that winter? Some of you might remember that winter. How many of you remember that winter? Because if you were in it, you remember it. It was record-breaking. We literally walked up on to the tops of houses on snowdrifts. It was unbelievable. Everything was closed. Everything. But it was Sunday morning. And Dad said, we got to go to church. And he said, get up early. We're getting on the snowmobiles and we're going to church. Now you have to understand that we lived 18 miles away from the church. He said, that doesn't mean anything. The snowmobiles will be gassed up. You be ready. And we're going. And we got up and we left early. We pulled our snowmobiles into the parking lot. Pastor Corbin came out and said, what in the world are you doing? Dad said, well, It's church day, isn't it? He came out of that house, went over and preached to me and my mom and my dad and my two brothers, and that's all. It was church. I never had a problem with the preacher saying, "You just, if the doors are open, you go." I just never had a problem with that. And so when preacher said, "You need to go to Tennessee Temple University," I said, "Well, okay." We really didn't know anything about what that even meant. That night, there was a youth activity like there's going to be here tonight, real similar to the same type of idea. In that youth activity, a math teacher from my high school came up behind me and tapped me on the shoulder and said, "Hey, Brent, I need to talk to you." He was my math teacher. Tom Bridge was his name. He took me over in a corner. All the youth were doing their thing and having activities, whatever. He took me over in the corner and he said, "What are you doing?" I said, "What do you mean, what am I doing?" He said, "What? You really think you're going to go to college? You really think you're going to go to Bible school?" I said, "Well, I think that's what God wants me to do." He said, "Don't." He said, "You know that you'll never make it. Don't waste your money and don't waste your time. Don't go to college." He was speaking truth. I was a horrible student. I wasn't interested in school. I was interested in playing drums. I was a professional drummer. I was teaching people how to play drums when I was 17 years old. I was getting paid to teach them how to play. It's what I was going to do for the rest of my life. I really didn't care about math and social studies and history and all that stuff. When I was in the sixth grade, I was playing first chair in the varsity band. I was very, very serious about it. I didn't have a problem letting everybody know how serious I was about it. But my grades suffered horribly. The only time I ever disrespected my mother was over my grades. She told me one day, she said, "Brent, if ever you come home with another one of these grades," which was an F or a D, she said, "I'm cutting your hair." That was a big deal for me because I had the hair that you would think I would have as a drummer. And it's not bad now for 67. Can you imagine what it was at 17? I had it. I was pretty proud of it. And my mom chased me all over our backyard with a switch, trying to catch me to cut that hair, and I never did let her. I disrespected her so bad, I wish I could take it back. And Tom Bridge said, "Don't go." It was pretty discouraging, to be honest with you. But I knew God wanted us to go. And so, right after I graduated in 1975, that summer, my wife and I were engaged for marriage. We were 18 then, we were married at 19. But before we got married, I went and spent one semester down at Tennessee Temple. It was horrible. I mean, you talk about wasting money. I completely wasted money. I didn't pass one course. I couldn't do anything but think about the fiance that I had at home. I don't know how stupid of a decision that was to go do that. I have no idea. But that next summer, we came home, and my wife and I got married, and we left Somerset Center, Michigan, and headed for Chattanooga, Tennessee. My wife is a brain, and she never did struggle with anything. And we left, and we took our tent and spent the first 6 months of our marriage living in a tent in a campground in Chattanooga, Tennessee, because that's all we could afford. And we stayed in that tent until November. The only reason we got out of the tent was because it got too cold to stay in it. We were pretty proud of it, to be honest. I mean, we had a nice, fancy tent, had a screen house, and in the screen house, we had our own refrigerator. We were uptown. I mean, you know, we were your typical little tent campers. We had this thing together. It wasn't cell phones back then. My wife called her dad from a payphone. Her dad wasn't saved. She called to witness to him, and she began to scream in the phone booth. I was outside the phone booth. There was not enough room, you know, in one of the phone booths for two of us, and she was in there, and all of a sudden she started screaming. I thought, oh, my soul, what has happened? And her dad told her that he had just got saved. Oh, my soul, what a day. What a day that was. That end of that semester, I got a note in my mailbox at the college campus from the Dean of Men. I thought, that's kind of cool. Not everybody gets to go see the Dean of Men, right? I thought, this must be something good. So I had an appointment time, and I went in to see the Dean of Men. Dr. Price is his name. He set me down, and he said, Brent, I don't know what you're doing here, but you should go home. I said, what do you mean I should go home? He said, you're not going to make it. You're not passing one course. You're way behind on your bill. You're completely wasting your time. Why are you here? You just need to go home. And I thought to myself, I've heard this before. Why am I hearing this again? And he said, well, I'm not just saying that you should go home. I'm telling you that you have to. We're dismissing you from school. I said, that doesn't make any sense to me. I know I'm struggling, but I am doing the very best that I possibly can. Have to work a full-time job along with trying to get through school and married, and it's tough, but this is where God wants me to be. I can't imagine. He said, well, God might have wanted you to be here, but he doesn't want you to be here now. You need to go. I walked out of that office and walked right across the street. And across the street, there was a building with a name above the door that said Dr. Lee Robertson. You might know that name. He's the founder of Tennessee Temple University, pastor of Highland Park Baptist Church, and I thought, well, I don't know. Maybe I'll go see if I can talk to him about this. Remember, I don't know much about this stuff. I'm a little ignorant on this stuff, okay? And so I walked across the street and walked in the office, and the secretary met me, and she said, can I help you? And I said, I'd like to see that Dr. Lee Robertson. And she said, do you have an appointment? I said, no. Do I need one? She said, well, yeah. You can't really see him without an appointment. And he came out the door. We came out the door. He said, and who is this? And I introduced myself, and he said, can I help you with something? I said, well, I'd like to talk to you for a minute if possible. He said, yeah, come on back in. And I went into Dr. Lee Robertson's office. Just me and him. I had no idea. I'm talking to Dr. Lee Robertson across from the desk. He said, how can I help you? I said, well, there's an office across the street, Dr. Price's office, I think it is. He said, yes, sir, my dean of men. I said, he just told me I have to go home. He said, well, why would he tell you you have to go home? I said, well, because I'm not passing anything and I'm a horrible student. And he said, I'm wasting my time. He said, well, Brent, why are you here? I said, because God called me. He said, okay. He picked up his phone, called Dr. Price, and said, Dr. Price, this is Dr. Robertson. Brent Marwelli is in my office, and he's not going home. Let him stay. I thought, well, that was cool. Wasn't too much to that. Amen? And so we got through that semester, and God moved us, actually. We left Tennessee Temple University and went back to Michigan and attended Faithway Baptist College. That's back before there was a Faithway Canada. It was in Ypsilanti, Michigan. And Faithway Baptist College in Ypsilanti, Michigan had a student population of 67. And I went from a classroom of 125 students and one teacher to three students and one teacher, and my grades went straight up to A's and B's for the rest of the 3 years. I just needed that attention. I needed that one-on-one. I needed that relationship with the teachers to motivate me to be able to get this thing done. 1981 was when we graduated together, and they had a preacher boys contest every year, and I won the preacher boys contest that year, and I preached at my commencement service. Who would have ever thought? I I need to just fast forward. Right out of college, we went down to Fort Walton Beach, Florida, where I was a youth pastor for 3 years, and then we moved to Oxford, Alabama, where I was a youth pastor for 2 years, and then the Lord moved us back to Michigan because of family situations. And I remember my professor asking me if I would go help him in a camp situation, a youth camp. He said Dr. Kirkland was going to be the speaker. You might know that name. I didn't know that name. I do now. And Dr. Kirkland was a speaker, and this was 1980. And Dr. Kirkland preached Romans 12, 1 and 2. I beseech you, therefore, by the brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. The invitation came, and I left that chapel of that camp and went out on a rickety old dock in a mosquito-infested swamp and stood on that dock and began to present my whole body. Dr. Kirkland had preached that specifically. He said, from the top of your head to the sole of your feet. And he started naming every part. He went into very detailed specifics, saying, this is not just, Lord, I give myself to you. He said, give them your hair. He said, to me, give them your hair. I thought, okay. Do you know how many young men there are today walking around not doing what God wants them to do because they can't get victory over their hair? He said, give them your eyes. Ask God to help you not to see things that will disqualify you from ever doing anything effective for the Lord. And I gave him my eyes. He said, give them your ears. Give them your mouth. Give them your hands. And just went through all the specifics. I totally surrendered myself to the Lord that night, and everything changed in 1980. That's the moment that it all changed. That's the moment that everything came together in the process of doing what God wanted me to do. Shortly after that, I became pastor of the Calvary Baptist Church in Hillsdale, Michigan, which is quite a story. We were in transition between ministries, and I was selling cars to make money, selling new and used Fords. And the general manager of the Ford dealership came to me one day. He said, Brent, I don't know how or what or who told me this, but are you a preacher? I said, well, I actually am. He said, well, I attend Calvary Baptist Church right here in this town, and we've lost our pastor, and we don't have anybody to preach this Sunday. Want to preach? I said, absolutely. I want to preach. And so I went there and preached. That Sunday, he came back to me at work that next week and said, want a pastor? I said, Now, I can't answer that one quite as quick. A little bit more to that. So we went through the process and became the pastor of Calvary Baptist Church in Hillsdale, Michigan. What I didn't understand is that at one time, the church was running a couple hundred people, and the service that I was there was 19. And so they were going through some pretty serious things. I was still pretty young, didn't understand what that all meant. Well, a couple years later, they're back up to 150, sometimes 175, sometimes 200. And God blessed them in a very unique and special way. God moved us from Hillsdale to Jackson, Michigan, Loomis Park Baptist Church, where I'd pastored for 15 years. At Loomis Park, in 2009, my wife and I came home from vacation, And I was walking down the center aisle, or the side aisle, coming to the pulpit to preach, and a deacon met me in the aisle and said, "We need to meet with you after church today." I said, "Why do you need to meet with me after church?" He said, "You just be there." I don't have time to go into all the details, but while I was gone, a couple of staff members had got with several people in the church over the course of some time and made very serious false accusations against me. Don't need to go into the details, but as a result, the Lord transitioned us out of there. It was all false. It was all wicked, wicked things that, anyway. That next week, I got a call from a man by the name of Jerry Rockwell. Jerry Rockwell was Dr. Charles Keene's scheduler. Jerry Rockwell said, "Brent, I understand that you're transitioning out of pastoring. What are you going to do?" And I said, "I don't know. I have no idea." He said, "Well, can I call you back in a few minutes?" I said, "Sure." And he didn't call me back, but Dr. Charles Keene called me. He was in Knoxville, Tennessee at Crown College at the time. And he said, "Brent, this is Dr. Keene. Was wondering if you and Shelley might want to come down and see me. I'd like to talk to you about something." Well, that was at Crown College, and our only son was at Crown College at the time, so it was like, yeah, we'll be glad to come down. We get to see Jordan. So we went down, sat in his office, and he told us about First Bible. And he said, after the interview, he said, "Brent, I can't offer you one thing, but you can use my name." When Dr. Keene said, "You can use my name," I looked at him right in the eyes and I said, "Dr. Keene, I'll take that." And we went from a 20-year pastoral benefit, all that there is to do financially, to absolutely zero. We had just built a new house. My father-in-law is a builder, and we thought it was going to be our retirement house. We had debt. And all of a sudden, we had zero income. And now I'm going to go to work for a ministry that has offers zero income. Go ahead and say, "That's dumb." Go ahead. I wouldn't counsel anybody to do that. 2 years later, I took my wife out for a date on our anniversary. And I wrote her a note. And on that note, after 2 years of being with First Bible International, the note said, "Shelley, I just want you to know that as of this day, we are 100% debt-free." That's humanly impossible. And now we've been with First Bible for 14 years. When I was a student at Tennessee Temple University, I remember sitting in chapel one very specific day. Dr. Jack Hudson was preaching, best I can remember. And I remember as I sat there, yep, right there, the Holy Spirit saying to me, one day I'm going to use you in a way that you're not going to believe. That day started 14 years ago. And for the last 14 years of my life, I have experienced overwhelming joy in serving the Lord. And I wouldn't trade it for anything. I would never want to go through what we had to go through in order to make the transition ever again. But if I knew I'd be able to do what I'm doing today as a result of it, I would do it 100 times over. Why do I spend all this time saying all that to you? I'm not sure. Except to say, what are you waiting for? If God could take me with zero, zero potential for anything at all at 15, and begin a life in me that I can't even imagine that he would do through me, and allow me now to do what God is allowing me to do. I'm privileged to preach in different churches almost every week of my life, in churches like this. You say, you think that's, yeah, it's the greatest. Do I get to preach at Pembina Valley? Uh-huh. Do I get to preach at churches with a whole lot more people? Yeah. But they're not like this. Now, Pembina Valley is, but a lot of those other churches, they're not like this. You see, a lot of those churches, you're the missionary. You'll experience that. Where is he? You'll experience that. For some churches you'll go to, you're the missionary. You know, have to have one every month, and you're it, and glad you're here. Here's your love offering, and you'll never hear from them again. But there's some like this, where you begin to build a lifelong relationship with, that gets it, that gets the vision, that gets the burden. And the reproduction begins. Heavenly Father, we are so humbled in your presence just to think that you would take somebody from Addison, Michigan, with zero knowledge of you or anything to do with you, and do a work in his life through so many unbelievable means, to finally get me to the place so many years later where you could use me in a ministry so great as First Bible International. I just can't believe it. The more I think about it, the more I talk to my wife about it, Heavenly Father, I just can't believe that you allow me to be a part of something so big with such a great scope that reaches so many people with the gospel. With our heads bowed and our eyes closed, if anything would come out of this testimony, the thing I'd want to come out of the testimony is for you to understand that if God is calling you, I want you to know that you're not giving up anything. You're not sacrificing one thing. You're entering into the greatest life imaginable in serving the Lord. There's nothing like it. There's not one job that you could ever do that will even come close to matching the lasting, everyday satisfaction that there is in serving the Lord Jesus Christ with all your heart. Why not surrender? Why not be that person that would say, Lord, I might not know when, and I might not know where, and I certainly don't know how, but whenever and wherever and how you ever you want to do it, here am I. Send me wherever it is. Use me however it is. Whenever I'm at a place where you can do it. Before we start more of an invitation, if you're in that group, why don't you come right now and commit that to the Lord?